Good morning, and welcome to God's house. What a great, great, great day it is to be together. Hey, I want to give a couple of brief instructions as we go, just because, as you might know, we're doing today a little bit differently than we typically have done confirmation. I want my confirmants to know that it is on page 10 when you will be welcomed up here. So if all of a sudden you're feeling the desire to do an altar call earlier in the service, just stay put. It's not until page 10, so until we're on page 10, you just sit back, sing, listen, worship, all that kind of stuff. When page 10 arrives and I welcome you up here, I'll walk you through instructions for how we're going to do that. So typically before confirmation, we have a big practice and we walk them through each and every step of the way. Didn't do that this year, so we are all 100% equally ignorant about how this goes. So forgive us our process. We'll do our best to make this happen, and we're just glad to be able to do this inside God's house today. I have been asked by numerous people if this counts as church for the weekend or if they're supposed to come back tomorrow. Been asked that three times. I've only talked to my family, so you can... So that we're celebrating both confirmation today and also Reformation weekend. So anyhow, it's so good for us to be together. Please stand as we begin. This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. Better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Sanctify us in your truth. Your word is truth. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Our epistle reading for today is from Paul's letter to the church in Rome, chapter 3. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be stopped, and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and are justified by his grace as a gift, through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of our boasting? It is excluded. By what kind of law? By a law of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that one is justified by faith apart from works of the law. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. From John 8, so Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples. You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." They answered him, "We are offspring of Abraham, and have never been enslaved to anyone, how is it that you say you will become free? Jesus answered them, truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The Son remains forever. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Forever, O Lord, your word is firmly set in the heavens. Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. Blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it. Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit. Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. We sing.
Please be seated. Well, grace, mercy, and peace be yours from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. This weekend we celebrate Reformation, a great festival in our church year. Red is on the altar, and we celebrate that rediscovery of the gospel by Luther and the Reformers, this truth that we are saved by grace alone through faith, not by our works or merit, but by our Lord Jesus and what he has done for us. Here you see a picture of Martin Luther in 1521 before the Emperor Charles at the Diet of Worms. And in that moment, he was standing by what he had written about the truth of the scriptures, and he stood before the emperor and said, "These things I believe, and here I stand." And I think it's kind of neat that over the past several years, Zion has begun to celebrate confirmation on Reformation Sunday, because here too, today, 31 young men and women are going to stand firmly on the gospel truth. They're going to be saying to the world and to all who will hear, "Here I stand. This is my truth." And I pray that each and every one of you will stand on this promise until you take your final breath. Now, in our church on Reformation, the readings that we hear read are the same every year. And always this Sunday, unless someone changes it, we hear those words from John chapter 8 you heard read earlier. "If the Son sets you free, well, you are free indeed." Now, this reading is a fine selection for Reformation, but you may have noticed it's a little short. And it can become challenging year after year to find a new angle to take on this text. And I have to be honest with you, usually my practice has been to find some important quote from Martin Luther and use that almost as my text. But today, celebrating confirmation in the context of Reformation, I heard some new things. And I'm hoping to preach those things into your ears this day. First, I think it's important we ask ourselves, what exactly is Jesus setting us free from? Let's take a look at the text. John writes to those listening that day to Jesus, asked him, "How is it that you say we will become free? We've never been slaves to anyone," they protested. And Jesus answered them and he said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin." See, that's what we, you and me, were before knowing the Son and his promises. We were slaves to sin. And if slaves to sin, then also death and hell. But, and this is the most important point, in knowing Jesus and his promises, we are set free from these things. We are set free from our sin. And I love this silhouetted picture of Jesus I saw once a few years ago. On that cross are written all kinds of words that we use to name sin in our lives. And if you probably look up there, you'll probably notice a few that are particularly problematic in your own life. But then written in red, reminiscent of Jesus' blood that was shed on that crossbeam, are these words from 2 Corinthians 5:21. They say, "God has made him," that is Jesus, "who knew no sin, to be sin for us, so that we would become the righteousness of God." Jesus, who is without sin, takes all our sin on himself on that cross. And so if we are connected to Jesus, then the promise is we are set free from our sin. He gets our sin. We get his righteousness. If you remember nothing else from your confirmation sermon, if this is the point where you usually start turning the pastor off, remember this one. And most important truth, in Jesus you are set free. This verse is talking about how you are set free from sin by the Son who you trust in. That's the point of the Christian faith. That's the point of the Reformation. That's the point of your confirmation here today. Above all, that you say before the world that you know that to be true. But along with that promise come a whole bunch of other blessings. Setting you free from sin is not the only benefit that comes from knowing Jesus in this world. When you are set free by Jesus, you're also set free in many ways from something I call the burden of choice. You see, as you live your lives, and you you'll find this out if you haven't already, you'll continually be bombarded by all these choices you need to make every day, and most of them are pretty insignificant, but some of them are life-changing. And they are ultimately a very heavy burden that we bear. Now, many of you would think of choice as being freeing. That's what you've been taught in our American society. You've been taught that not having your own choice is one of the worst things. But while we might think choices are freeing, they can be a great burden. Let me illustrate this for you with a simple example. Say you're going to the grocery store to get some barbecue sauce for dinner, okay? Imagine, if you will, that there was only one brand and one flavor of barbecue sauce. You would walk into that store, you'd pick up the bottle without even thinking about it. You'd pay, get in the car, drive home, eat your dinner. No emotional agony expended. Simple as that. But consider the reality. If you walk into a grocery store for barbecue sauce, you are bombarded by a myriad of options, flavors, and brands. Should you go with trusty Sweet Baby Ray's, or are you in an open pit kind of mood? Maybe KC Masterpiece. And then let's say you decide on Sweet Baby Ray's. Then what? Are you in the mood for a spicy or sweet or maybe some North Carolina vinegar base? Are we talking Texas hot here or Kansas City smoke? And on it could go. You might find yourself staring at that aisle for 2, 3, who knows, 5 minutes. And then even after you've made your selection on the way home, you may find yourself second-guessing, wondering, maybe I should have got the other thing. Choices can be a burden. Now, this is just a silly little example about barbecue sauce. You might be thinking, what's the big deal? But in life, our choices can be really big deals. Consider, for instance, this question, the question of what is truth? People in our world are all the time offering you differing opinions of what they call really true, and it can be bewildering. But look what Jesus says in this text. He says, if you abide in me, then you will know the truth, and that truth will set you free. Think about that. If you know Jesus, if you abide in him, if you've learned his word, then his word has taught you and continues to teach you what is true. What is ultimately true? And if you know that, it sets you free. It sets you free from this great burden your entire life long of having to try to worry about what is true and what is not. And so say you're out with a friend sometime and a group of friends and they're doing something that might be illegal. Who knows? They want you to join in the fun. They tell you it's not really that wrong, so just come along. You don't have to wonder whether they're right or not. You have God in his word, and it tells you what truth is. Or say you're in a classroom someday, and the teacher is trying to tell you how you came into being or how the world came to be. They're proffering their version of truth. You don't have to be burdened by that. You don't have to wonder. You have God in his word, and it tells you you were created by him in his image, and you have value, and you are important. No matter what it comes to, when you live your life, when you're worrying about how you're going to go about living, Jesus frees you from the burden when he teaches you the truth, and he says, these are my ways. Walk in them. But that is not all. Knowing Jesus not only sets you free from determining what is true, he sets you free from determining who you really are. Those Jewish people standing around Jesus that day said to him, we are Abraham's offspring. That's who we are. Were his children. You see, what they knew is that if they were considered slaves, that meant they could be kicked out of the house at any time. But if they could claim the status of children, then that meant they were rightful heirs to God and his promises. So who are you? Well, I'll tell you. I'll tell you what Jesus tells you. He says, here's who you are. You are his baptized child. He has claimed you in the waters of holy baptism, many of you at that very font. And in that day, he adopted you as his child. And that means you have a place in his house forever. You never have to wonder who you are. Now, many people in our world face the burden their entire life long of wondering, who am I really? When I was a kid, growing up, I remember some older kids than me, I was always hearing about kids who were taking a year off, not working, not going to school. They needed a year to really find themselves. Depression, sadness, loneliness are way up among today's youth. And one of the main reasons they know is that kids today have no sense of identity, no sense of grounding, no one telling them who they are or whether they have worth. You probably will feel this way at times. But when you do, remember this truth. You are God's child. You have value. He told you that when he bled and died for you. He loves you, and no matter what the world or anyone in it might ever say to you, what God says to you is what matters, and it is true. You see, Jesus sets us free from the consequences of our sin. He sets us free from having to determine what is true or not. We know he and his word are truth. He sets us free from ever having to wonder who we really are. We are his dear children. And finally, Jesus sets us free from determining what our true purpose is in this world. I hate to break it to you today. Maybe you've already started to think about it. But all of you, all 31 of you, over the next decade or so of your life are going to be making decisions that impact the rest of your life. And maybe when you look ahead, you do feel like these things are a huge burden. You'll be faced with questions already about where are you going to high school? What kind of classes are you going to be taking? College prep or more of a trades route? What kind of activities do you think you'll be involved in when you get there? How are you going to study for these tests? And on life's decisions go. And then pretty soon, sooner or later, you're going to be facing pressures of going to college. And people will be asking you, where do you want to go? What kind of career might you want to pursue? And you're going to have to think about what you're going to major in and study. And are you going to do what makes you happy or what makes you the most money? Or are you going to base it on where you can live? And on these decisions go. And then perhaps someday you'll meet someone and you like them. And you're wondering, is this the person that I'm going to marry? And let's say you do get married. Now all of a sudden you're wondering, wow, are we going to have a family? Are we going to have children together? And lo and behold, in 20 years you might find yourself sitting in these same seats facing all these decisions all over again with your own children. Whew. Now unfortunately, knowing Jesus doesn't absolve you from making these decisions along the way, and yes, they will be burdensome, but I want to remind you today that smack dab in the middle of all of them is this one reality that will never, ever change. Smack dab in the middle of all of it is the reality that above all, your purpose is being a disciple of Jesus. Whether you're a doctor someday or a lawyer or one of the most amazing stay-at-home moms we've ever seen, whatever you do, you'll do it as a follower of Jesus. Of course, you'll have other purposes. Of course, those will be important as you serve your neighbor and whatever God calls you to. But you never have to wonder, what am I doing here? You never have to ask yourself, what's the point of my life? Jesus sets you free from that when he says to you, you are my disciples. Now come, follow me. You see, in a few moments, you're going to come up here, and through the rite of confirmation, you are going to affirm the promises of your baptism. That means you're going to say yes to those promises. In your baptism, God set you free. He took away your sin. He told you what is true. He claimed you as his child. He gave you a purpose. And now it's your turn. It's your turn to come up here and say, yes, Lord, I want to be set free. When you know Jesus, you know the truth. When you know the truth, life is so much easier to live. The truth of God's word will set you free. And Jesus tells us once again on this Reformation celebration, if the Son has set you free, you are free. Indeed. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We rise and sing.
Please be seated. A couple instructions before we come up. When our confirmands are invited up in a moment, I'll be bringing all of them up. They are in alphabetical order, distance around the communion railing, starting with Bates over there, right over there. Please make sure your confirmand, as they come up, has a bulletin. That would be very, very helpful. Also, they'll not be returning to their pew between their confirmation and their communion, so I expect to smell the scent of anti-bac in the air any moment now. Please use that on the way in. Confirmands, when you come up, you'll be coming up here, you'll be standing. We'll walk through the questions and answers of the profession of faith. I'll have all of you kneel while you're confirmed. Quick reminder, I think it says this on the top of page 12. Our habit at Zion is when your family member is being confirmed, you are invited to please stand. You'll remain kneeling while we go all the way around. I'll have you stand back up for the communion liturgy, and then I'll kneel for communion. So, confirmands, bulletin in hand, please come up and find your spot. Bates, Wright, everybody else. Also, congregation, these young men and young women today make a confession of faith which joins them as adult members to the church. Because of that, we'll not leave them alone in this profession. They'll be joining their voice to yours. So the questions I ask, although intended for them, at their confirmation day are also an opportunity for you to reaffirm the vows that you made at your confirmation. So the responses in after the R are for all of us. Beloved in the Lord, our Lord Jesus Christ said to his apostles, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." You have been baptized and taught in the Christian faith according to our Lord's bidding. Jesus said, "Whoever confesses me before men, I will also confess before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven." Lift up your hearts, therefore, to the God of all grace, and joyfully give answer to what I now ask you in the name of the Lord. Do you this day, in the presence of God and of this congregation, acknowledge the gifts that God gave you in your baptism? Yes, I do. Do you renounce the devil? Yes, I renounce him. Do you renounce all his works? Yes, I renounce them. Do you renounce all his ways? Yes, I renounce them. Do you believe in God the Father Almighty? Yes, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord? Yes, I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? Yes, I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Do you hold all the prophetic and apostolic scriptures to be the inspired word of God? I do. Do you confess the doctrine of the Evangelical Lutheran Church drawn from the scriptures, as you have learned to know it from the small catechism, to be faithful and true? I do. Do you intend to hear the word of God and receive the Lord's Supper faithfully? I do, by the grace of God. Do you intend to live according to the word of God, and in faith, word, and deed, to remain true to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, even to death? I do, by the grace of God. Do you intend to continue steadfast in this confession in church, and to suffer all, even death, rather than fall away from it? I do, by the grace of God. We rejoice with thankful hearts that you have been baptized and have received the teaching of the Lord. You have confessed the faith and been absolved of your sins. As you continue to hear the Lord's word and receive his blessed sacrament, he who has begun a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. Amen. Confirmands, you may kneel. Please remain kneeling as we go all the way around from beginning to end. Logan Wesley Bates, Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me.
Establish you in Christ and draw you into his all-embracing love continually.
Lauren Faith Benz, Joshua 1:9. Have I not commanded you? Be strong, be courageous. Do not be frightened and do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go.
And Lauren, may God guide you, may he strengthen you in his promises and build you into the kingdom of his Son.
Hannah Elizabeth Bingaman, Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not for evil.
And Hannah, may our loving God, the giver of all we possess, the source of all our blessings, form you in thanks and praise forever.
Braden Hunter Koosman, Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through him who strengthens me.
And Braden, may the Holy Spirit help you to grow in faith, hope, and love so that you may know real peace, truth, and goodness.
Nicholas Lee Culler, Jeremiah 17:14. Heal me, O Lord, and I shall be healed. Save me, and I shall be saved, for you are my praise.
Nicholas, may your ears hear God's voice, may your eyes see God's presence in all things, and may your lips proclaim his holy word.
Caitlin Marie Diani, 1 Samuel 16:7. For the Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks on outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart.
And Caitlin, may your heart be God's dwelling place forever. May your hands do works of love in his name. May your feet walk in the way of Jesus Christ.
Jacob Michael Fiebercorn, Psalm 27:1. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
Jacob, may the Spirit of God grant you the gift of wisdom to see the world through his eyes, the gifts of knowledge and understanding to use your mind to know and to love God. Madeline Faith Kearns, Isaiah 41:10. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous hand.
Maddie, may our God, who called you his own at your baptism, continue to guide and lead you to live the gifts he has given.
Blake Nicholas Merritt, Colossians 3:23. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters.
Blake, may the Lord Jesus be clearly present in your life, your words, and your works forever. May your life as a redeemed child of God announce his salvation to everyone.
Quentin Rowe Owens, Matthew 4:19. And he said to them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men.
Quentin, may the Father of love and power establish you in Christ and draw you into his all-embracing love continually.
James Joseph Perkins, Psalm 103, verses 1 through 4. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy.
James, may God guide you, may he strengthen you in his promises and build you into the kingdom of his Son.
Evelyn Wren Rowland, 1 Corinthians 15:52-53. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality.
Evelyn, may our loving God, the giver of all we possess, the source of all our blessings, form in you thanks and praise forever.
Austin James Seamers, Psalm 46:1, God is our refuge and strength, always ready to help in times of trouble.
Austin, may the Holy Spirit help you to grow in faith, hope, and love, so you may know real peace, truth, and goodness.
And Dominic Robert Wright, Proverbs 16:3, commit to the Lord whatever you do, and your plans will succeed.
Dominic, may your ears hear God's voice, may your eyes see God's presence in all things, and may your lips proclaim His word. Confirmands, would you please stand? We're on the top of page 13 in your worship bulletin. We're going to remain standing through page 13, so during our questions, the Lord's Prayer, and the words of institution. After the words of institution, I'll invite you to kneel again, and then Pastor Fieberkorn and I will bring around our plates. Each plate has one wafer, one small cup of wine. After the plate is brought to you, you will take and eat, and then take and drink. Do you believe that you are a sinner? Yes, I believe it. I am a sinner. How do you know this? From the Ten Commandments, which I have not kept. Are you sorry for your sins? Yes, I am sorry that I have sinned against God. What have you deserved from God because of your sins? His wrath and displeasure, temporal death, and eternal damnation. But do you hope to be saved? Yes, that is my hope. In whom then do you trust? In my dear Lord Jesus Christ. What has Christ done for you that you trust in him? He died for me and shed his blood for me on the cross for the forgiveness of sins. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the same night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." Confirmands, if you would please kneel and remain kneeling while we commune your whole class. pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for your great goodness in bringing these, your sons and daughters, to the knowledge of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and enabling them both with the heart to believe and with the mouth to confess his saving name. Grant that bringing forth the fruits of faith, they may continue steadfast and victorious to the day when all who have fought the good fight of faith shall receive the crown of righteousness. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Peace be with you. Amen. You can leave your communion stuff where you are. You can grab your confirmation certificate and your bulletin and return to your seats, please. Please stand. We pray. Almighty and gracious Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep us steadfast in your grace and truth. Protect and deliver us in times of temptation. Defend us against all enemies and grant to your church your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Almighty and Merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless and preserve you. Amen.